Before we start, I will not fight Pep because I actually have a knee injury from a sparring match that just popped, like right now while I was trying to do a wiggle dance. So, yeah. Okay, so I'm here to talk to you about how to listen to your customers effectively, and I just want to clarify that that might sound like a total snooze fest, but it is not. So just bear with me for 15 minutes, and I promise you I'm going to make it worth it. So, when it comes to succeeding in business, one piece of advice never seems to change, right? It always comes back, listen to your customers. Be customer obsessed, you know? But there's just one little problem with that piece of advice. We fucking suck at listening, right? Like, I don't know about you, but my husband will definitely confirm that listening 100% does not come naturally to me, right? So, and as marketers, we're even worse, right? We are notorious for asking the wrong questions to the wrong people at the wrong time. And just to exemplify what I mean by that, I just want to play a short example for you, or an audio clip from very talented comedian Tig Notaro, describing what it was like dealing with her mother's affairs after her mother tragically died of a head injury. This happens, like, all the time, and this is an extreme example, but we do have, with all the surveys and all the polls that we put out, we have a really strong tendency of relentlessly asking our customers a ton of questions and doing, like, fuck all with the answers, right? We just collect it all and we just sit on it. And then, when it comes to actually coming up with what to test, so often we have these, like, internal meetings where we come up with, like, hunches and opinions about what our customers want, and we don't actually go back to the information that we have. So if I were to sum up this situation in one word, we're assholes. We're like that annoying friend who takes you to brunch and they want to ask you what they should do with their douchebag boyfriend for like the 11th million time and then does not take your advice. Right? So just ask yourself, take a minute and think about what you actually do with the information that you collect about your customers and the questions that you ask them on a regular basis and how much of that information you actually synthesize and like build into changes and improvements for your website. And just ask yourself, am I an asshole? You know? We all are to some extent. But the truth is, listening at scale to your customers is like legit hard. Right? Especially when you're getting unstructured feedback, right? Like long-form answers, interviews, that kind of stuff. And when it comes to product messaging and copywriting, which is my wheelhouse, richer feedback, which is the most insightful, often requires way more work and it scales very badly. Like, polls scale wonderfully, but they will only point you in the right direction. They will not actually give you what the story is that you need to put on your sales page. So, how do we stop being assholes, right? Just to say, there is the like high-tech solution, which I think that Guillaume is going to get into tomorrow, where you can go start diving into AI and you can start diving into machine learning and text mining analysis and all that stuff and try to automate everything and like analyze all your unstructured feedback. I'm not going to talk about that, but I would love to talk about that with people who are interested in that later. At the end of the day, the non-technical solution is good listeners have a tendency to ask good questions. This was actually a study of, like, it came out in the Harvard Business Review. They did a study based on about 3,900 managers who were in a coaching program and tried to find out if there are any correlations in how they behaved with how people perceived them as good or bad listeners. And number one thing is, like, they ask good, intentional questions. So we need to really get in the habit of stop asking questions on autopilot, which I guarantee you, we are all guilty of at some level at wherever we work, right? We just take survey templates and we just shoot them out there and then we just like take the information, right? At the end of the day, what's crucial is we have to actually sit down and reverse engineer what we need to know. We need to think about, okay, what do we actually need to know to improve the sales process? Like, what are the things that we don't know? Well, not what are the things that we don't know, but what are the things that we'd like to know about, right? How are we going to get the answers to illuminate this issue? And how are we actually going to analyze the information that we get back. Because sometimes you can get an unscalable amount of input, and then you're never even going to look at it. So, like, why did you even ask in the first place? So I'm just going to go quickly over one of my favorite listening tricks. And I say tricks because tricks sound, I don't know, magical, but really it's just a process. And what I like to do, especially with new clients who want to, like, optimize a homepage, is I like to try to devise higher converting value propositions using just three questions that I ask customers and prospects, right? But before I jump into that, I just want to clarify what I mean by a unique value proposition. Because when you look online, there are all kinds of different definitions, and everyone has their own definition. And this is my personal favorite, the value proposition canvas, right? Which for early stage companies that, like, have no customers, totally valid exercise. I think it's worth doing. But the inner pragmatist in me, the copywriter, when I look at something like this, when it comes down to devising a value, like an effective value proposition, I just think this. Right? because at the end of the day, a value proposition in the eyes of your customer, right, should just be a simple, logical, compelling answer to the question, why should I choose you instead of somebody else? That's it, right? You don't need these crazy, like, positioning statements. You just need one sentence or a couple of sentences that work to get that across. So, just a quick recap. Let's not worry about all those crazy jargon-filled definitions, right? Core elements of an effective value proposition. Number one, it needs to be relevant to your customer. If you are not immediately talking about something that your visitor or prospect cares about when they come to learn about you, obviously they are going to leave. So it has to be relevant. Number two, you need to get across a desired outcome. And that gets back to what Chris Goward was talking about in his talk, right? You need to be able to paint them a picture in as many words as you need to compel them or to explain them what they're going to get, how their life is going to improve by actually putting in the work and paying the money to get your product. And then finally, the thing that most companies tend to spend enormous amounts of time on when they're coming up with a value proposition and they don't really think too much about the other ones is that exclusive benefit, that exclusive differentiator, right? What is it that they can get from you that they can't get somewhere else? And when you get those, this diagram was originally a pyramid, and then I was like, we're in Texas, so I'm gonna make it a bullseye. But when you get that, then you end up getting a message that you can get across that, like, immediately hits all those good points, and at the very least makes the user stay. So here's my radical idea that comes back to the idea of listening to your customers. Why don't we just let our customers define our UVP, our value proposition, right? Why are we all sitting around in a boardroom trying to come up with these different ideas? Why don't we actually go to them and tell them and ask them straight up, like, why did they actually use us? And you might say, well, why do we do this? And I would say, because as salespeople and marketers, on the, like, just being on the selling side, we are really bad with coming up with value propositions, right? It does not come naturally. That is why there are so many webinars on it. There are worksheets. There are all kinds of different expensive, like, courses and stuff that you can take to try to come up with that sentence, that message that people are going to, that's going to resonate with your customers. Right? But when we are customers, when we are in the role of trying to figure out what to buy, we are, like, value proposition generating machines. Like, we're doing it constantly because we're just going out online all the time and figuring out, okay, X or Y, X or Y. Should I choose this? Should I choose that? Right? And every time we come up with a compelling value proposition in our heads, even if we're not openly conscious of it, we buy. We put our money where our mouth is, right? Or where our thoughts are, I guess. So it makes sense to ask our customers and to get this information from our customers and to build our value propositions based on what our customers are saying with regards to our value proposition because they've gone ahead, they already created a value proposition in their head and they backed it up with money. So they're a huge resource. Why are we talking amongst ourselves? Let's talk to them. So what questions should we ask, right? To get to the bottom of this and to get this information out of our customers. First thing, for relevance, what I like to do is I'll put up a question. You can use a poll, you can use a survey, it doesn't matter. on your homepage of your website asking, what matters most to you when buying X, whatever you happen to be selling, right? You'll be surprised the number of people who will actually answer this question. You might think that they won't, but if you word it in the right way and you don't make it too obstructive, they will answer. Number two, right, when we're talking about desired outcomes, send out a survey to your customers, and in one of those questions, make sure that one of them is, what is the number one benefit that you get out of using whatever product you happen to be selling, or a type of product, right, that you happen to be selling? And that can be a benefit that's actually like an enhancement, or it can be the elimination of a problem, right? So you can phrase it either way. But they will then paint that picture for you in an open form response, right? And that stuff is gold for sales copywriting. And then finally, ask that third question to get the exclusive benefit. I mean, at the end of the day, you bought from us and not someone else. Why? Right? And they will give you, most of the time, a pretty clear answer. So you ask your paying customers that. And then, I was supposed to take that out, and I just like, so now it's just going to come up, and it's just going to shoot every time. Right? So back in the fall, I actually taught a course on product messaging and sales page copywriting for conversion, or for CXL. And as part of the course, what I did was I optimized a homepage in real time that belonged to one of the students, right? And so for this one, it was Pet Doors. It was the homepage of petdoors.com. And they sold car batteries. No, they sold Pet Doors, right? And I just want to take a quick look at what their value, they tried to put it, they did put a value proposition right up front on their homepage, which is usually a pretty good practice to do. Widest selection of pet doors handpicked by the most experienced in the business. We have the widest selection of pet doors available, over 40 years of experience, ensure you find the product you need. That's pretty good. Like, that's decent. It's definitely a differentiator, right? Is it actually speaking to the actual desired outcome that the prospect wants? Not necessarily, right? So let's go back to this idea of asking our customers questions that will help illuminate if we can come up with a better value proposition by asking them those three questions. So number one, ask your visitors what matters most to you when buying a pet door, for example, right? And this is an important point because one of the really cool tactics when it comes to writing conversion copy is like you can look over, you can grab and swipe information from user reviews or customer reviews and use that to shape your copy. But in this case, I didn't know which, there were all kinds of messages about different benefits, and I didn't know which one was the top one, right? So I grabbed a whole bunch that I found in pretty equal frequency from these messages, and then I made options. I gave them like six different options that they could choose from, and it could be, you know, price, what it looks like, how easy it is to install, all that stuff. And what I, And what we found was durability and toughness and weather resistance was like more than 50% of the responses that we got voted for that over everything else, including price, right? And I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't actually gone out and checked it. Like I could have picked, I actually thought it was gonna be installation, right? Because a lot of people said that that was a nice thing to have, so that could have been a good value proposition. And then I asked the customers, paying customers, what's the number one benefit of having a pet, of the pet door that you got from us, right? And it turned out that the answer that they gave, and sometimes in vivid detail that we could actually use on the sales page, was pet freedom and happiness, right? And what's interesting about that is that, like, the terms that they put it in were actually quite colorful because it really comes down to pet freedom and happiness. They want their pets to be able to, dogs especially, to be able to come and go as they please when they're not home, right? But an added benefit of that is that they don't end up shitting on the carpet, which is a huge concern. They don't want their dog to be depressed. They also don't want their dog to be, you know, making a mess in their house. And then finally, as the final like cherry or like the bullseye within all of that, the number one reason they ended up coming to PetDoors.com and buying from them over other alternatives was because PetDoors.com had that specific part or had a specific brand or whatever, best selection, that they had what they needed, right? So that became the core elements of our new value proposition. This was going to be the value proposition, the elements of the value proposition that we were going to put on the optimized homepage that I ended up putting together for the class. So just to I don't think I need to show you this again, but again, remember, value proposition, petdoors.com. Why does selection? And then we put together an optimized homepage, and we built all the messaging that we had on this homepage around those three core elements, right? And it was a longer page. I am going to put that up. Like, we didn't just change a headline, and then it just, like, had amazing results. But we put those, especially in that hero section, we put the value proposition up front. Shop the world's largest selection of built-to-last, weather-tight pet doors. Give your dog or cat the complete freedom to come and go as they please while keeping your home insulated, secure, and pet accident-free. Because I couldn't say they won't shit on your carpet. And I think it's important to actually just note that almost none of the words in this value proposition focused hero copy came from me, right? This all, almost all of those words came from survey responses, and I just picked them based on the research we had, and I knew the messages that we needed to convey, and then I used the colorful copy that they had come up with on their own and crafted this new message, right? And the results were actually pretty cool. We didn't test it in the course because the course ended, but I went back with the CEO of PetDoors.com, and we ran the optimized page against the control. And ultimately, we ended up getting a 51% increase in purchase rate, which was pretty rad. And on top of that, we ended up seeing a 92% increase in revenue per users that entered the site through the homepage, right? So that's a huge improvement, and that's based on just the fact that we went and we talked and we listened to our customers and we used the information that they gave us to be able to define the messaging that we ended up putting on the homepage, right? So that's pretty awesome. So just to sum up, moral of the story, do what you can to not be an asshole to your customers, right? Ask better questions. Be a better listener, and you will get more conversions. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Oh, all right.
And while you were up here, Chris Goward wrote me that he accepts your challenge, and he is expecting a large ask whooping. His words, not mine.
Also, this book, if you, not to like upsell it or anything, but if you actually are interested in like the step-by-step process of like how to do those three questions and implement it, you can grab that, and then it maps everything out with like the questions and stuff. Cool. I'm gonna get down.
Thank you.